Guys, we're in for a treat. Eric Bogosian is here. Let's hear it one more time. Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you.
It's a big time for you right now. You got a lot going on.
I do. I have, I'm on a TV show, so I'm in your living room every Sunday night on Billions and being a nasty guy on that. And
you're then a hedge fund billionaire on that.
I'm not a hedge fund. I'm an investment banker, but I'm just as evil as the hedge fund guys. And then in a couple of weeks, The Get Down comes back on Netflix, and I get to continue to torture Horizon on that show. So that's a lot of fun too. And then the book just came. That's good. This came out in Softbound last week, and. Yeah, and then we have our website, 100monologues.com.
Monologues, which is wonderful. Let's start with 100 Monologues.
Okay.
I was watching some of those this afternoon, and Michael Stuhlbarg delivers a beautiful monologue on there. There are all these monologues
exquisite.
That you've written over the years, right?
Well, I used to be at the Public Theater, which is just a few blocks from here, for a number of years. And then anyway, between 1980 and 2000, I was off Broadway with six different major shows that were they were built out of monologues, and they did pretty well. One day I was sort of bored and I counted how many monologues I had done, and I had done 100. So I went to my publisher and I said, what do you think about, let's put out a book, call it 100 Monologues. And I was playing poker with some of my actor buddies. I don't know who was at the table, Liev or somebody, Bobby Cannavale or somebody, and they were like joking about, would be funny if we tried doing these monologues. And so we started recording them a couple of years ago, and they're like all the best actors in New York are on. We got 64 of them posted now, and they're kind of cool, and they're free. You just go on 100monologues.com and see your favorite actor.
So what's it like watching other people do monologues that you've really only done yourself, and I would imagine probably rarely saw yourself doing?
Yeah, I don't know what I look like doing them. I like the writing. I love watching actors work. I mean, one of the most exciting things about doing this is that I meet with each actor. We have a meeting, and then we rehearse for a couple of weeks, and then we shoot it. And every one of these guys, and these are the best out there, all have a different way of breaking it down, working on it, building it, and creating the character. And I love watching. I love seeing what they're doing.
And now you appear in one of the monologues, but you appear as a man by the name of Ricky Cheese, right?
Something,
And it's just but we don't actually see your face.
No, just my mouth.
Shot of your mouth.
Yeah.
What made you?
I don't know. I decided to do it.
Me?
Oh, because it's a fun bit, and I wrote it with my son Travis. It's a fake Dunkin' Donuts. Before they did the one on SNL, I did mine. Everybody's just stealing from me constantly. So it's a fake Dunkin' ad for some kind of breakfast treat that is just so filled with carbohydrates and fat and bacon that you just would choke on it. And that's what that one is about. It's just a short one. Yeah, I mean, some of them are lengthy. I mean, we just posted one on Tuesday by a wonderful actor named Jamie Jackson, who is on The Get Down with me. And it's 15 minutes long. He memorized 15 minutes and just kills it. It's one of my favorite ones.
Now, going back to your monologues, I think, you know, talk radio, right, was your first big show. Was that your first big show? It got turned into a movie? Initially a one-man show, right?
No. I had done monologue shows before that, and then because of the success of them, Joe Papp said to me, you can do whatever you want to do over here at the Public. And I said, well, I have an idea for a play. It was a play. It was me playing this talk radio guy. And I don't know. I mean, we put it up. I didn't think there was going to be, I thought we were going to run for 4 weeks and that was it. And instead it changed my life. We ended up running for 6 months. And then I did the movie with Oliver Stone. And the movie has survived through this whole period of, you know, when you make a movie, it's like, is it going to make it to a VHS tape? Is it going to make it to a DVD? Is it going to make it to streaming? And so it still lives. And it's
streamed it on Amazon Saturday night.
Yeah,
it's still there.
It's an unusual piece. The odd thing for me is that because so many of the beats that are happening to the character in the story are like things that were happening to me then, It's like watching myself in a time machine from 25 years.
Like all the personal
years.
Stuff? In yeah, terms of
yeah,
how
like,
you
like
sort of
yelling
make
at my
career.
Wife or something, yeah. or just all the tension and stuff. And it's like going back in a time machine and looking at what my life was like then, because it was pretty intense. I had a lot going on at that time.
You get a sense of that while watching it, because it feels like, oh, this is a sort of an indictment of this anonymous call-in show and the hate that can be spewed on it, but this also just feels like the life of a young artist who's trying to make it somehow and is completely
well, that's driven. That's what I started with. I mean, even though the thing is called Talk Radio and it's about talk radio, it was really about John Belushi. That was what I started with, because I was very interested in how far will somebody go to get an audience? What will they do? And John Belushi was really kind of almost out of control just before he died. And it was like the audiences were just cheering him on, like, yeah, yeah, do more drugs, do more horrible stuff to yourself. And we see that all the time. And we see horrible tragedies in this world that we live in of people just...
We just saw that in a presidential election.
Yes, yeah, yeah. I wish that one would implode. Yeah, I'm waiting for that Hindenburg disaster to finish up. But at any rate, so I wanted to, and I had those same impulses. I think everybody who is in show business understands that there's this tremendous pull from the audience that wants to get you to go nuts. And you have to decide, like, where you're going to go with it. I mean, Chappelle, who just has this new concerts on Netflix right now, I mean, he walked away. Why did he walk away from that show? Because the characters he was playing, he felt he couldn't stand behind, and yet the audience couldn't wait for him to be even nastier and more screwed up. And I felt that same pressure on stage, and I knew it was there for me. And the question is, what do you want to do? Who are you talking to? Are you talking to everybody, or are you talking to an audience who you think of as sort of like, oh, that's me out there, and what would I like to hear up there? What turns me on?
What I thought was so fascinating about talk radio when I watched it was that I was also in the middle of reading this book, Operation Nemesis, which is a historical account of...
I'm laughing because it has nothing to do with these things, but I mean, well, no, I mean, I'm glad that you brought it up, but...
Well, I think it's interesting because...
It's like a history book.
Well, that's what I mean. You see an artist in the mid-80s, a young artist trying to make sense of the now and in that moment, and then you see an older artist sort of looking back at history to also make sense of the now, if that makes sense. It seems like Operation Nemesis starts for you because, one, your grandparents, but also you're trying to make sense of geopolitical situations right now that keep happening cyclically, almost, it feels like. And so you go back
absolutely.
To what you feel like is the beginning.
Well, first of all, I'm Armenian ancestry. My grandparents came over from Turkey, and I heard about the Armenian genocide a lot when I was a kid. I don't know that I completely understood what they were talking about. I mean, they're talking about massacres for a three-year-old or a five-year-old to really wrap his mind around all of that.
Bedtime stories.
Yeah. I think for a long time, especially as an actor who is clearly ethnic, whatever that means exactly, I wanted to keep that at arm's length. I didn't want people constantly thinking of me in those terms. You gotta go back to the 80s when I'm starting out, and when I have an agent at William Morris take me out to lunch and say, Eric, I think you have a really great career. You just have to change your last name, straighten your hair, and fix your nose, and I think we're on here. And I didn't want to do those things. I was very proud of my heritage, but at the same time, I was like, I don't want to just be playing like terrorists or something my whole career. So that had always been at arm length. Then, more recently, I did a movie with Adam Egoyan called Ararat, and this ignited in me a sense of pride about my own people and also curiosity about what actually happened. Then I found out about this team of assassins, and so then I had something I could work on and write about. And it was a terrific experience. And you talk about the young artist versus an older artist. My young stuff is really, I mean, I worked in clubs, and it was comedy, and it was kind of punk. And everything was like, just shoot it out there fast and hard, which I could do, but as an older person, I can focus on one thing. I mean, this took 7 years and required a lot of research and work, and I could never have done this when I was 30 or 27 or whenever I was doing those other things. And now I can sit and I can focus. I mean, honestly, halfway through, I was ready to give up.
Why is that? Because halfway,
I'm not a scholar. I mean, the work was unlike anything I'd ever done before. I had to do so much research, and then I didn't know how to put it all together.
But I think that's what makes it so wonderful, is that it's incredible storytelling. When you're describing the scenes of genocide, it's horrifying. It's one of the sort of more visceral and I think graphic depictions of genocide that we have. But then outside of that, when you get into the group that are sort of exacting revenge on those that committed this genocide or at least ordered it, it feels like Munich. It's an incredible thriller.
And it's about
Munich with reason.
Yeah, like and 50 years earlier. Yeah. I just so everybody gets what we're actually talking about. What happened was after the Armenian genocide, a group of small businessmen in the New York and New England area decided that they couldn't let this thing go by. This is not a made up story. This is a true story that there had been no book about. That's why I had to write the book. And they recruited guys who had experience with guns and killing from the war, and they sent them all over Europe, and they tracked down all the Turkish leaders, and they killed six of them. And they assassinated basically the leadership that had done the genocide to the Armenians. This is a story that had been sort of hidden. And there was one assassination that people knew about, the killing of Talat Pasha, that it was part of this. And these guys called themselves Operation Nemesis. They only existed for 2 years. They were horribly effective. They managed to kill something like 10 people. But they got all these leaders, and they exacted revenge on that leadership. And yet, Turkey doesn't want to talk about genocide, some Armenians don't want to talk about the violence in this story. But I think it was an amazing story simply because, I mean, if you know that these people are responsible for the deaths of millions of your people, your countrymen, don't you feel like you have a right to go find them and exact punishment, which was being ignored and continues to be ignored because the United States has a strategic relationship with Turkey and has decided to never say anything or do anything about what had happened?
You have that great quote in the book from the film The Act of Killing, which is that, you know, those who get away with the war crimes get to define, I'm paraphrasing here,
yeah,
excuse me, get to define who were the war criminals. Right.
Absolutely. I mean, we are. That's our story too.
So to say, we see that
the United States has done all kinds of horrible things, and we don't. If you ask an average person, what country ever actually used nuclear weapons against another country? I don't think most people would know the answer to that question. And of course, it's us. And we killed hundreds of thousands of Japanese who were just going about their business. Not only did we drop a bomb on them and wipe them out, and then 2 days later we did it again, just because we wanted to see how the bombs worked. It wasn't because we really had to. I think they got the message with the first bomb. And so that stuff, no punishment, there's no anything with that. And we are the victors.
And I think because you're discussing genocide and you're specifically discussing World War I and in some points the lead up to World War II, you're talking about nationalism a lot of the time, which has a much more ringing context, I think, right now than maybe even when you released the book a couple of years ago. You know, we're talking the word nationalism and white nationalism specifically is in the media and all around us every day right now.
Nationalism is a tool that's used by leaders to promote their agendas, which are usually not in the interest of the people who are subscribing to this nationalism, particularly war, and particularly World War I, but it's ongoing. World War I, all these young guys, all in France, Germany, Britain, and the United States, and in Turkey, couldn't wait to go to war because they were patriotic and they felt very strongly about it, and then found themselves mired in hell. I mean, literally hell. Gallipoli and the trench warfare and all these things are beyond our imagination of how horrible these things were. And there was really, I mean, at the end of the day, this was something that the leaders, certainly, they didn't have to do anything. They had nothing at risk. They're risking young people's lives. And this goes on. I mean, I'm not going to make apologies for being a pacifist, and I'm not going to make apologies about my stance on these things. I was marching against the Iraq war before it even happened, and it has happened exactly the way that it looked like it was, even worse. I couldn't even imagine how horribly this has all turned out. And yet somehow we still have the leadership that somehow is selling this baloney to
the Bush administration on steroids right now. That's what the Trump administration feels like to me.
And you have a, you know, I come from a blue-collar town. And in a blue-collar town, young people feel, I mean, it's just natural for a young man to want to do the right thing, be patriotic, and sign up. And I think it's a, I think it's a bad deal for people to go into this, and the way we treat our veterans is absolutely reprehensible. I've worked with wounded warriors through my the Writers Guild, and the stories you hear are sickening. How our country abandons the wounded after they come back. So I don't see an upside to any of this, and I will talk about it, and I will say things about it. But of course, this is 100 years ago. This is one country deciding that they want to wipe out the indigenous people, the Armenian Christians, in a Muslim country, and we're seeing the same thing happening right now. I mean, the kind of intercommunal killing that is happening in Syria is all about what the guys at the top want. It's not about what the people at the bottom. They just want to have their village, and they want to go down the street and get some bread and raise their kids. And instead, they have to, this whole refugee thing and everything is horrible.
Well, that's how you start the book. You start the book with, and maybe it was written for the paperback, where you say, you know, when you wrote this, I think you say when you wrote this, the refugee crisis hadn't really started yet when you were working on this book. And now it's so clear why these things keep happening.
Yeah. I mean, I don't see... right now in the Sudan, right now in Syria, right now in Ukraine, all of these things are things that are happening because the leadership wants them to happen, not because, I mean, like I say, the local people are just really not thinking that way. And I have to say our own leadership is somewhat responsible. The debacle in the Sudan is something that they saw coming. Any idiot could have seen this coming. Syria was a client state of Russia. Again, why did we start this? Why did we encourage this? Iraq and Ukraine, anybody from Europe can tell you that Ukraine is, Russia is not gonna let you take Ukraine any more than we're gonna let Russia take Canada from us. It's part of their sphere of influence. This sounds terribly sophisticated what I'm saying, but it's actually not. This is like the most rudimentary stuff that our State Department is supposed to. Well, we're not going to have a State Department anymore now, I guess. We don't need one.
We
don't need any department anymore. I'm sorry. Everybody's like getting very sad. They're all very sad. I don't want to depress everybody.
What is it like for you playing an invet? You're a New Yorker. You've lived here for, you know, 30, 40 years at this point. What is it like for you playing an investment banker, someone that people would say, you know, a guy that has more money than God, like that the title of that book, who has an incredible amount of influence over politics? Do you think about that, or do you just kind of focus on the sort of soap opera elements of the show? And I don't mean soap opera pejoratively at all. Excuse me.
I mean, honestly, it was only like, this is going to sound idiotic, but just like 2 years ago, I finally understood why I love to act. And I love to act, I mean, the applause was great when I was a kid and I first went on stage and I was in high school. It was a lot of fun. Later, it became a profession. I got paid for it. I've gotten a couple of awards. Under Siege 2, yeah. But I mean, pretending to be somebody else is just such a high for me. And to play these kind of guys who are really over-the-top bad guys is just so much fun. I think that the audiences know it's a construction and a contrivance, and I'm just getting off on it. Now, when you get to work with the likes of a Damian Lewis or a Paul Giamatti, and you get into a scene with these guys take it to reality. They take the reality up a notch, and all of a sudden, you're there. And you're not pretending anymore. You are the guy, and they are the guy, and you are in this reality together. And it's like flying. It's just so exciting. So for me, I mean, I'm a born and bred actor. I go back to like, I don't know, when it was 10th grade or something, I started acting. And I just love going into that space with someone. Now, as far as what the show is about, Billions, and I think it's insightful to what goes on between these guys as sort of pissing contests that they get into, and also that some of the people in the government are maybe not as pure as some people like to believe. I don't believe it, but so when Paul Giamatti plays a guy who has cross purposes when he's going after this hedge fund guy, because Paul Giamatti plays the
he plays
what's called a U.S. attorney for the right. Southern District, which is what Preet Bharara, I think that's if I'm saying his name right, that's it was his position. So at any rate, all of that's I think that's insightful, and I know the guys who write the show are they're doing their homework, and it's all important. So I think it's all part of a bigger project to illuminate this. Now, I will quote from Damien, who says to me personally, he said, you know, I play this guy, and then bros are coming up to me in the street and going, yeah, all right, man. And it's like, I hate those people. I don't want to be one of those people. I don't want to be their hero. I don't know if I'm anybody's hero. I don't know. I've had some guys come up to me in the gym or go, yeah, so you're going to jail for that now. I didn't go to jail for that.
Finance bros have always done that. They did that with Michael Douglas with Wall Street,
right.
Who was like clearly the villain in that movie, but because he was so sleek, they loved that he was the villain. And
But wait a minute. Would you ever want to be Michael Douglas? No. Would you ever want to be Damian Lewis? Yes. So he's a much more appealing lead. He's a guy who I think... I wouldn't mind being Damian Lewis and walk around in all his tight clothes.
What's it like for you doing...
Have Malin Ackerman be my wife on TV.
She's the best. What's it like for you doing these two shows, which I think it sounds like, based on the style of the shows, they're very different in terms of the style of acting that you would be doing. And The Get Down is a bit more...
They're completely
musical.
Different.
Yeah.
Completely different. The Get Down is all about... I think there's going to be animation in the next... I don't know if I'm giving something away, but I mean, it's broad and we're into it. And Baz Luhrman, of course, is a guy who paints in big, very colorful strokes. And it was a chaotic set. It was a crazy set. We have a lot of young people. If you just compare those two groups, The Get Down is all mostly young actors who are probably on screen for the first time ever. Billions is all seasoned actors who have done a lot of stuff and who are amazing. These guys are amazing too, the Get Down people, but they're bringing a rawness and a newness to the whole thing of when you shoot a TV show, like Learn Your Lines, something like that might be something that may not be immediately apparent to a younger person showing up, you know.
It's actually true. I mean, I've heard stories like that with younger people, and even like young actors who get on a set for the first time, they expect that they're going to have more time and that they're going to be able to play or improv a little bit, and they didn't know that things are going to be moving so fast. They have to know their lines.
Yeah, I mean, it honestly, The Get Down was a growing process for everybody involved in the show, but the chaos was like a controlled chaos that led to some really great results over time, and I think especially with the next six episodes that are coming on, you're going to see more and more of this show understanding what it is and what it's about. I mean, basically it's Justice versus Horizon, and Justice is hip-hop and Horizon is disco, and I'm not that significant in the storyline. The storyline is really about a kind of Romeo-Juliet situation where they're really on two sides of a fence. The funny thing about The Get Down for me is that I'm probably one of only two people on the show who have actually anything to do with the original hip-hop world. I toured with the Rocksteady Crew in 1982 with Crazy Legs and Frosty Freeze. And
How did that happen?
I used to be part of a art center that was down here on Broome Street called The Kitchen, and they decided to grab up a bunch of people and send them out to the Midwest, and I was doing some obnoxious thing at the time that I used to do in punk clubs, and then these guys were brand new. I mean, people in the rest of the country had heard hip-hop at this point. Hip-hop was all over the place. They called it rap more than hip-hop, and then... But breakdancing people hadn't seen, and it was incredible to hit Pittsburgh or Minneapolis or Toronto and have Frosty come out and start spinning on the top of his head, and their just watch people's jaws drop, because they really, if you can imagine having never seen it, it was so I used to watch every single show that these kids did, and they were kids. That's one of the things I really like about The Get Down, is that they're very young, and the original hip-hop scene was really young, teenagers.
I'm going to go back to a history question for you for a second, because you wrote
let's get back to this
book.
Let's get depressed again. They're all starting to smile a little
bit.
Well,
we're going to go to questions from the audience, so they'll get their rocks off in a second. This is like kind of a personal thing, because watching talk radio again this weekend and reading Operation Nemesis and just reading the moment in the book where Warren Harding becomes the president, basically, he says that, and you say in the book, you know, he won a landslide victory, so he ushered in this sort of this administration of corruption, because he thought that he had won this landslide victory. Feels very similar to right now, where they feel like they've won a landslide victory. And then with talk radio, these anonymous hateful callers feel very similar to what we talk about now when we talk about commenters on Reddit and 4chan and sort of neo-Nazi KKK commenters sort of issuing hate across the board, any channel that they can find anonymously. It made me almost feel really good, because it was like, oh, these things have always been happening. Like, as a 33-year-old man, having like a very political, I've always been slightly political, but now I feel like, you know, I can't stop watching the news and everything feels really disastrous. It also feels, reading this and watching talk radio, it's not that disastrous. Well, this is stuff that has happened before.
Well, I'm glad you feel that way. And I say to people, you know, if you're that concerned about Trump, please go back and look at Warren G. Harding, because his administration was so corrupt. They had, I think, a tunnel going out from under the White House to some neighboring building where they could play poker and have whores and stuff. So, I mean, and all of his guys were just the nastiest people. It was the Teapot Dome scandal, and they were as corrupt as it gets. He ended up dying of a heart attack while he was president. He was so out of it. But I'm glad that you feel that way. One thing that I think is very important to remember in this, as we get adjusted to the new media environment that we're in, is that there's a lot of people who are invested in keeping us freaked out. And it's not necessarily the bad guys. It could be people we think of as good guys. But they're making a living keeping us on the edge of our seats every day, freaked out of our mind. Now, that doesn't mean that this Trump administration is a good administration, but I think that in the bigger picture, these things that are very American, these dynamics are going to continue and have continued, and they play in ways that I think it's worth looking at history. For example, in the 30s, when the Depression was going on, the country was very aware of communism, and as a result, encouraged unions unionism was a way to undermine communism. Once they had communism out of the way, you could just map it. Watch the unions just get crushed. And so these people who know, they know that if you screw the little guy enough, they're going to rise up. But sometimes in unpredictable ways, which is what has just happened now with Trump. I mean, that's what people are doing. I live not only in the city, but in northern New Jersey. And everybody up there is Trump. And they have their motivation is that they're just sick and tired of the way they've been treated. And I get that. I think it behooves all of us to get that a little bit more and understand how screwed the average guy who's trying to pull a regular paycheck is. I mean, every year your money is worth less. So that's why. But why does it have to be Trump? I think that I don't know if I'm a Bernie guy, but I just think, why can't people get in front of audiences and just really say what they really feel and what they really mean, and enough with this hedging everything that you say in front of, because you're afraid you're going to miss this group or that group. If you're against the war, be against the war. If you're for medical insurance for people, be for it. The part I really don't get is that we have no trouble wasting hundreds of millions of dollars on war. And if you want a school or a hospital, it's like pulling teeth. It's, oh, we can't afford it. And then they start this thing about that's big government and they're taking your taxes. And I'll say, listen, they're taking your taxes. It's a question of where is it going? Sorry, I'm going to run for president by the end of this. That's it. This is it. Today, it starts here. It starts here.
I think
Lincoln started up at Cooper Union. and that's how he started by making a speech. I'll make a speech here and run for president.
I'll just add to this really fast before we go to the audience again. Sorry, guys. I know you want to ask about nice, fun things.
There's sleep there.
But I think there's also like a kind of cancerous underbelly in this country, which is a fear of collective unity. And we're so built around this individualistic idea of the person as the worker rather than the sort of workers coming together or the people coming together to effect change. That's why it's so easy to get people against universal healthcare or against any kind of healthcare that the government is working on to get people organized for better wages. It's almost impossible at this point in this country, not just because of the laws that make it that way, but because for the last, I think, since unions started dying, there's been this incredible propagandistic campaign for the individual, you know, starting really with Reagan. And from there, it's impossible to have a conversation with anybody about like, hey, no, look, it's good if the government gives you health care. I don't want the government telling me what to do. Every other Western country does. They have health care. You know, it's this very strange personality that our culture has developed into.
Well, perhaps there's some hope in all the media outlets that exist now so that we can get maybe more dialogue going. I mean, look, Hillary did win the election as far as popular vote. So we do know that there are more people in the United States who are pro-Hillary than are pro-Trump. So, I mean, let's just keep moving in that direction towards sanity, toward gun control, and other things that just make common sense. And I'm not ready to give up. I mean, it's a struggle always. And if you look at the sort of the arc of what has happened in the law over the last 50 years, it is progressive. I mean, it's kind of odd because
I agree with that. Yeah.
Yesterday, Trump came up with this one of his idiotic statements, which he says, in case you don't know, Lincoln was a Republican, because nobody knows that, of course.
Because no Republican ever just says the party of Lincoln every time they talk.
But the other guy that he didn't mention who was also Republican was Teddy Roosevelt. And Teddy Roosevelt was a trust buster and he supported progressivism and all that kind of stuff. So there's it's entirely possible to have people get into office and push, I don't know why progressive sounds like a nasty word, but anyways, progressive agendas.
Nixon also created the EPA. He was essentially pro-labor, I mean, for the purpose of gaining votes. But, you know, there is a line of progressivism within the Republican Party.
I'm not clear on what the line is right now, other than how do we let the rich guys get even richer, and that's basically what seems to be there. I mean, when the smoke clears and when all this is done, that's what you're going to see has happened. It's going to be that. I mean, they do things like, say, veterans. They want to support veterans when running for. I don't know why Hillary didn't talk about it more. I feel very strongly about veterans' needs, but we won't see any change for veterans. We won't see things get better for veterans. Costs money, and there's no big rich thing that's supporting this. And even this, all this money going into the military, we won't see it going to people. We'll see it going to buy more insanely expensive, unnecessary pieces of armament that, you know, another aircraft carrier or something, which really, I mean, right now we could blow the whole world in half if we wanted to tomorrow.
And get sold to like a small Missouri parish, you know, sheriff's office to like blow down four people's doors.
Yeah, I want to see an aircraft carrier like going up the Mississippi River and like attacking drug dealers' homes.
The government sold it to us.
Yeah, it was free.
Who has questions out here? I'm sure. Right here.
Hey, Eric.
Hi.
Going to your book, I was wondering, like, how easy do you think it is for victims of like any type of genocide or something to be start late if once they stop becoming peaceful and start fighting back to be labeled aggressors or like terrorists or whatever, and like from the perspective of, you know, whoever was causing the genocide or whatever in the first place.
Well, it's another, I mean, you're talking about the people who don't have any power in whatever area we're talking about, and then the people in power, and then so the people out of power might be doing something, something violent, which I don't know that I'm behind that or not, but it would have to be judged in every circumstance. But certainly the people in power, controlling information is what it's all about. So that's how people get labeled the way that they do. And that's the tough one. You know, it's not so much are these people justified in doing a terrorist act or not, which is typical of terrorism. Terrorism is originally defined as powerless people trying to get the attention of the world. They do something, and then hopefully people say, oh, these people, we should pay attention to what's going on to them with them.
There used to be far more sort of left-leaning terror organizations at a certain point, at least from in the 60s and 70s.
Well, I mean, unfortunately, all of these things get co-opted into larger, I keep using the word agenda, but I mean, in the 70s particularly, and in the 80s, the United States and Russia were at war with each other in the Middle East using proxies. And you would have the CIA supporting one terrorist group while the KGB was supporting another terrorist group. And that, and you'd see these actions happening. And they're getting money in Syria being a perfect place, but also terrorism in France and other places. So we don't always know what these guys are up to. Like, we don't know when some money under the table is going to somebody just to create havoc. I mean, one of my theses, which anybody can argue with all they want, is that I believe that the CIA has done everything in their power to keep the Arabs and the Jews at each other's throats for the last 50 years, because if they ever made peace with each other, could you imagine what would happen to the world if the Jewish guys got together with the Arab guys and started figuring out how to really sell that oil in a way that was most profitable for the Middle East, for those countries? I mean, if you think about it, it sounds far-fetched, but the thing is, why not blow something up every once in a while to make sure that everybody continues to hate each other, and we'll never know who actually did it. So I didn't give you an answer to your question, but I'm not really running for president, so I don't have to actually have answers. I just have to say stuff.
And many people have put forward the theory that the CIA and the U.S. government blow stuff up a lot in the Middle East for the purpose of sort of destabilizing countries, sort of for the sake of actual, you know, Exxon and Shell and all these other oil companies.
It's all about oil.
Gain more, which the book ends up becoming about as well.
I think one thing that we need to do as a people is not think that these things are unthinkable, that there could be people in government who are doing things. Now, they call it, immediately this is undermined with the notion, oh, that's conspiracy theorist, things that have to do with 9/11 and so forth. But I actually think you can look at some historical examples that are so mind-blowing, things that Great Britain did during World War II that we can't get into all that now, but the thing is, it's really unbelievable, the tricky stuff that they did that involved people getting killed or things getting blown up on your side so that it would make the other side look bad, so then you could make the whole thing work better in your... And they'll do that. I mean, that's the way those guys think. They think all we really care about is the way it ends. So the people on the way, if people die, or who cares? And I would definitely think that a guy like Dick Cheney was not above that sort of stuff in the Bush administration, for sure.
Next question.
Hi.
Hi.
I wanted to go back to the 100 monologues.
Yeah.
I personally am terrible at finding and or doing monologues. I feel like it's entirely different.
You're hired.
I was going to say, it's an entirely an entirely different art form. I was wondering what kind of coaching or advice did you give these actors who are doing your monologues, or like anything you can provide?
Thanks. I don't think I could coach the people who did them on my, because they are pro on a level that's above things I can even comprehend in some place. You mentioned Michael Stuhlbarg. I was just working on a part that I'm doing on Saturday, and I was thinking about all I learned from just being around Michael, which was I was breaking down the script, and I was making a lot of notes to myself. And I do that because I've seen Michael make lots of notes when he's working on something. But in general, when I talk to actors about what is the best direction to go when you're working, is to really know what you're doing. And I think often we don't do that. We read the script and we feel that we've got it, and then we get very nervous about an audition or whatever. And the thing is that you just have to keep, it's not about memorizing lines, it's about knowing. Because the way our minds work, when we talk, like I'm not thinking about it's somehow bypassing that part of my brain that I use when I'm acting. So what is that? So, I mean, when you're in a play and you've been doing it for 3 months and you're saying the same lines every night, eventually it has that automatic feel to it. I think that when you're preparing a part, you want to get as close to that as you can get. I learned this on Woody Allen film I did years ago called Deconstructing Harry. Was that the name of it, Phil?
It's one of his best movies, in my opinion, yeah.
Yeah, and I've had only a few lines. It was Woody Allen. I decided that day that I would not spend all day at craft services sitting and complaining about my agent and talking to the other actors, but stay in my trailer and just review what I had to do that day. And he moves fairly slowly in a sort of a traditional way. They spent a lot of time on lighting. And I just kept working on these same seven lines, like over and over. And the weirdest thing happened. After about an hour of doing that, new patterns started to emerge in the material. I started to make some connections that I wasn't making right away and understanding what I was talking about. And when I finally came to do it, I really was in a different place than when I had arrived on set, believing I was ready to work that morning. And I was, and I would have done, I'm sure, something fine. But this deeper thing is, and I wonder now, I mean, I think a lot of professional actors, people I've been around who I really, they kind of just show up and they're doing their thing, like a Michael Shannon who's just incredible. And I wonder now, I realize they're doing so much work. They just don't want you to know, you know, they're probably, it's your job, you know? So no, don't just learn the lines and show up on set. It's not a party. It's not, we're not there to have fun. It's our job. And so yes, put in a week before you show up on set to say your one scene.
From what I understand, Shannon does like an incredible amount of work beforehand. Yeah.
Well, it shows. Yeah. It shows. And in fact, I think if you went on this website and you looked at the different people, I think they all do it. Yeah. They're Jessica Hecht or, I mean, they're all, that's why, I mean, in fact, there's some people who showed up who aren't as, you know, and they wouldn't be fully prepared. And I'd be like, that's why you're not, you know, you're complaining about it every night in the bar, but the thing is, that's why you're not working as much as this person over here. It's very unsexy. You know, it's not what we think it should be. It's like, just shoot from the hip. I'm Steve McQueen. I mean, that's not the way it works.
The process is never as sexy as the outcome unless you're obsessed and love the process.
Also, if you do the prep, then when you are shooting, it can have that fun, loose feeling. You can let that part go, although I don't think I ever look loose on screen, but.
The website, is it 100monologues.com?
Yeah, either the number or the word, but 100, the number, monologues.com.
And you've got, what, like 84 up there, right?
64 up there right now. And we're posting more, are coming, Winona's coming. Amazing. Soon, and that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
I said, okay, what's the craziest thing I get Winona to do? Okay, I want you to, could you do a homeless crazy woman on the street? And she did it, so.
You seen Stranger Things?
Of course.
Operation Nemesis, the assassination plot that avenged the Armenian genocide, is on bookshelves now, or Amazon.com, wherever people buy books. And Billions is on Sunday nights, or
I believe it's Sunday nights.
On Showtime. Yes. And The Get Down comes back to Netflix in a few weeks.
April 7th.
April 7th. Eric Bogosian, everybody. Eric, thank you so much.
Thank you.